I believe we are live. So hello, everyone, and welcome to the very first virtual live field trip of Berkeley Lab. We're located here in Berkeley, California. My name is Dan Croats, and I'm in the Public Affairs Department here. And with me is Stephen Brady, who's the manager of our Workforce Development and Education Office. So we're very pleased to have with us today two classrooms from nearby high schools. Let me see if I can pull up the first one. So joining us from Richmond, California is Richmond High School's Engineering Academy. So if you guys can make some noise, let us know that you're
doing.
Nice. And then a little bit further away, we have the Honors Biology class from Petaluma High School. Can you guys hear us?
Yeah!
All right, perfect. Looks like they're on board. I also want to welcome everyone who's watching online, our online viewership. Hopefully, this will be a good first introduction to the kind of science we do here at Berkeley Lab. Our tour guides today are spread out at three different locations around Berkeley Lab, and I'll really quickly introduce them before we talk about a little bit more about what they do on a daily basis. So over at the Advanced Light Source is Dula Parkinson. Hello, Dula. How you doing?
Hey, good.
Nice. And then further down the road at the lab here is Deirdre Olynick, and she is at the Molecular Foundry in some kind of clean room, and I guess we'll get the story about what she does there in a second. Can you hear us, Deirdre?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
We can hear you fine.
Okay.
Nice. Okay. And then next door is Jim Ciston at the National Center for Electron Microscopy, or NSEM for short. Can you hear us, Jim?
Yep. Hi, everybody.
Excellent. And now before we continue with the virtual field trip, Susan Brady here will give us a quick introduction to the lab and what we do.
So hi, everybody. We're so glad to have you be here. And here at Berkeley Lab, we're located right above the UC Berkeley campus in Berkeley, California. And we are one of the 17 national laboratories the Department of Energy runs across the country. And we investigate all types of things about matter and energy. One thing that we're looking into is how to create new sources of energy, alternative fuels and renewable fuels like biofuels, artificial photosynthesis. We're also looking at ways to conserve energy, so making energy efficient buildings, windows, better batteries, better ways to save energy. And then we also take a look at how our uses of energy really impact the world. So we're looking at environmental science, global climate change, things about how energy really impacts us as a society. In addition to doing those sort of applied challenges, we also look into just basic information about how is the world made, what are properties of matter and energy, from how did the universe start, what's it made out of, to what's the tiniest pieces of the universe and matter, and you know, looking into the insides of atoms. So we really look at the whole gamut of things about energy from all different aspects. We really believe in team science here at the lab. We have teams of scientists, engineers, technicians, and support staff that are all coming together to try to create new ways to meet challenges that our world faces. So we're really excited to have you join us. Today we're going to be looking at some people that look into the very tiniest part of our universe and try to explore some things about matter and energy in that way. So we're really looking forward to it, and I'm going to turn it back over and we'll hear what they have to tell us.
Excellent. So before we begin, I'd like to try to give you a little sense of where we'll be visiting today. So I'll pull up a virtual map. Let's see if I can do a screen share. Since this is a virtual tour, let's see if I can pull up our virtual map and give you a sense of where you'll be visiting today. Can everybody see that? There's a map, and we're going to start off with Dula. He's at the Advanced Light Source, which I just highlighted. And then we're going to move over to the Molecular Foundry, which is this cool-looking building right here. And then we're going to go right next door to the National Center for Electron Microscopy. So that's where you'll be visiting today. And we're located in Berkeley, California, here in the East Bay. Really quickly, we want to make this as interactive as possible. So for the two participating classrooms, we'll open it up to questions in between each scientist, a couple questions in between each. Then after all three scientists talk, we'll open it up to questions. So send us whatever questions you have. For folks watching online, you can send us questions a couple different ways. You can drop a question on the Google Plus event page that you could be watching this on. You can also email us at askberkeleylab@lbl.gov, or you can catch us on Twitter by tweeting to us with the hashtag Ask Berkeley Lab. So send us any and all questions, and we'll see if we get to them during the Hangout. So now I'll turn things over to Dula at the Advanced Light Source. I think the screen should be moving.
Okay, am I ready?
You're ready.
All right. Well, welcome, everybody. This is the Advanced Light Source. We call it the ALS. So as you saw on the map, the ALS is a big, round building. And inside this building, there's a big ring of electrons. So we have this big electron beam that runs around inside a pipe in the building. And we have a bunch of magnets that turn the electron beam and keep it going in a circle. Every time we have a magnet that turns the electron beam, it gives off a very intense beam of X-rays. And so what the Advanced Light Source is all about is about producing these extremely bright beams of X-rays. And we have 40 different places around this building that are using those beams of X-rays. So we have 40 different beamlines. We call them beamlines. And my job at the lab is to run one of those 40 beamlines. And so when the X-rays come down a pipe of my beamline, they come into a big lead-lined hutch. And what we're doing with the X-rays is doing X-ray 3D imaging. And so there's all kinds of things that you'd want to be able to take an X-ray picture of. Basically, the X-rays allow you to see inside something. Normally, when you look at something, you know, you can only see the outside. But the X-rays allow us to actually see inside of things in three dimensions. And so the way that works, it's probably hard to see because it's very small on your screens. But behind me, there's actually, you know, the X-rays come in, and we put our samples on this rotation mount, and the sample rotates around, and we take images from a whole bunch of different angles, and then we're able to reconstruct the 3D information. So I just wanted to give you a couple examples of the kinds of things that we image at our beamline. And the cool thing is that scientists from all over the world fly into Berkeley and bring their samples to this beamline to be able to image it, because our X-ray beam is so bright, they're able to do experiments very quickly and be able to see things that they wouldn't be able to see anywhere else. So it's really fun to work here, to be at a place where scientists are coming and bringing us their problems. So one of the examples that I wanted to give you, and I think Dan has a picture of this, is we're doing material science where we're interested in developing materials that can survive high stresses at high temperatures. Dan, do you have, is that one going to work?
I'm going to put it up right now. Can people see sort of a fuzzy image here? Is that...
Yeah, okay, so that's it's a little bit hard to see, but basically what we're doing is developing advanced composite materials. So when you make airplanes or different things, you want materials that are very light, lighter than metal, but they still need to be really strong. And for materials that are in jet engines, or if they're on the wings of supersonic jets, they have to be able to survive a lot of heat. So what we do here is we actually put the materials inside a furnace and we pull on them really, really hard. And what we want to see is how do these materials fail? Like, what does it take to make these materials fail? And exactly how do the cracks start in the materials? How do the cracks go through the material? And then we get all those 3D images and we see exactly where the cracks start and exactly where the cracks go. And what we're able to do then is actually make a computer model and understand exactly how that works and be able to then go back and develop new materials that are stronger and better. So that's one example of something we do. Another example is we study batteries. So we want to understand why do batteries fail. So like, you know, your iPhone has a battery in it, and you use it for the day, and then you charge it overnight, and then use it again, and eventually your battery wears out. Well, we want to understand why that happens. So one of the things that happens in a battery, so that in a battery there's two sides, and there's a membrane that separates them in the middle. And what we're able to image here is that as we cycle a battery, we're actually able to see these defects that form on the membrane and eventually puncture the membrane and cause the battery to short circuit. And so we're able to actually look in, and the resolution that we have here is on the micron scale. So your hair is about 50 microns or 100 microns thick. So we're able to see, you know, 50 or 100 times smaller than a hair is the size of the features that we're looking at. And we're able to see exactly why these things are happening that make the batteries fail. And the hope, again, is that if we can understand why the battery fails, we can understand how to make a better battery.
Awesome.
Dan, should I go on, Dan, or is that enough for now?
That's. Do we have any other questions from the classrooms? Or do you want to talk a little bit about, I have that cool image of the sort of the bone structure work that is
there. Oh, yeah. I can briefly tell about the bone. So we have a scientist who is from Marquette University in Wisconsin. And he works with a hospital there, and there's a team of doctors there that specialized in care for something called brittle bone disease. And it's a genetic disorder that makes the structure of people's bones be different. And mostly, most of their patients are children. And there are actually differences in the bones with this disease on the micro scale. It's not, you can see differences in the whole person. They look different. Their bones have problems. But the reason that they have problems on the person size is that there's microstructure inside the bones that's totally different. So I don't know if you flashed the picture up yet, Dan.
Yeah,
but
I have the picture up of the
okay.
Structure.
Okay. So yeah, so that's the bone. What's flashing up now is a normal bone, and then there's another image that he can put up. That's the diseased bone. And so like these chunks that you see of bone are actually only a millimeter big. So we're looking at like this tiny piece of bone, but there's very big differences between the normal bone and the diseased bone. And what we're able to do is actually work with the doctors and get samples and understand how the different treatments that they're doing of these children are affecting the microstructure of their bone in hopes that we can help them do better treatments.
Excellent. So that's a really good introduction to the Advanced Light Source and some of the really cool kinds of science that goes on there. Are there any questions from any of the two classrooms?
Oh, I've got a question from my second period class.
Okay.
Okay, so can you guys see me? Because right now I see myself only on the little small screen.
We can see you fine, and the sound is a little bit fuzzy, but you can try the question.
Let's get a little closer. How's that?
Okay, great.
Okay, so this question comes from one of my students in our second period block, so he's not coming here, but he had a question about the xylem and ferns, and if you could actually take a look at the structure of the xylem and the ferns to figure out whether it would have an advantage over taller plants that maybe have a less flexible xylem. Is that something you could image using the ALS?
Did you catch that, Dula? It's an imaging.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I did. So I love that question, and absolutely, yes, we actually have. So I've got to say that I am not an expert in plants, so I can't answer that side of the question, but what I can say is that we have scientists who have come from UC Davis, from UC Santa Cruz, and from the University of Florida, all of whom image the xylem and the structures that transport water inside plants. What they're looking at is how, at the UC Davis, they were looking at grapevines, and they were trying to figure out how can we make plants that are more drought resistant and more disease resistant. They've also looked at redwood trees. They've also looked at orange trees. They're looking at all these different plants and trying to understand how the tissue inside the plant works. So absolutely, we could definitely image that. And if your student is interested, he or she should contact me, and we could try some tests.
Well, we'll send out contact information after this. Any other quick question from any other classroom? We could have plenty of time for questions afterwards after all three speak, too. So,
sure, if you want us, otherwise we can meet.
What's that again?
I have one more.
Okay, let's go ahead.
Hi, does this work?
Yep.
All right, so Dr. Dula, I know you did, in your lab, you did some research with the Arapaima fish. Is that how you pronounce it?
Sorry, could you repeat that one more time?
The Arapaima fish. You did some research with the Arapaima fish. Is that how you say it?
Some kind of fish? Was that the...
Yeah. Is that...
No. Maybe.
Does that ring a bell? I didn't quite...
I'm not sure. Is it... Oh, with the... Yeah, so the armor of the fish.
Yeah,
is that what you're talking about? Yeah, that's right.
You guys said that they're a good example of material evolution because they're able to reorient themselves to resist force. So would you be able to use this technology, like you were talking about how you analyze these structures, would you be able to use this trait of theirs to be able to like manufacture some type of material that you'd be able to use in, say, like a bulletproof vest or some kind of like armor for humans?
Yeah, absolutely. So we actually have a few different researchers who are trying to develop materials that what the word that they use for it is biomimetic. So they're trying to like mimic biology. So they find these biological systems that have these amazing properties, and then we're trying to make materials that mimic that. And we actually do have multiple researchers who are trying to develop armor of various kinds. Some of their funding is from the military. and they're trying to develop the best armor possible. And so exactly like you say, they're trying to image these things, and they're trying to use those same design principles and make armor that follows those rules. So yes.
Excellent. So now we're going to move things over to the Molecular Foundry with Deirdre. And so Deirdre, where are you and why are you dressed like that? That's the first question, I guess. Can you hear us?
I can hear you. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Yes. So the first thing, I'm in a clean room. And in a clean room, we filter out the particles in the air. In the outside, you have about 35 million particles per cubic meter. And we filter that down to 100. And the reason we do that is because when we make the nanoscale devices in here using techniques that you might see in semiconductor industry, any particle that lands on our wafer, and I'll show you one in a minute, could contaminate it. So I have gotten permission to remove my glasses and my mask for today so you guys can see me better. But generally, we have to wear that because any skin, dust, hair, or spit could land on the wafer. So to start with, I'm sitting in front of a electron microscope, and Dominic Ziegler is here using it. Not only is it an electron microscope, which allows us to see images. I don't know if you can see his screen right here. It's a special sensor he's making, very unique. It's only made here. And it has electrons to image the sample, but he's also using ions at the same time to saw the device. He's cutting off the top of this device, if you can see it. So in my work, I use electrons to make structures similar to what people do in semiconductor to make devices that go on your phone or your computer, the chips. But instead of using light to make patterns, we use the electrons. So we use a tool like this that generates a beam of electrons. Can you throw up that image, first image?
Let me see if I can pull it up here. One more, and they should be seeing the schematic right
here. That's it. This is a very simple cartoon that illustrates how you would make a pattern with electrons. So we take a wafer, something like this, if you guys can see it, single crystal silicon. You can see it looks like a mirror. This is 200 millimeters. And then we take a polymer in solution. We spin it out so it makes a very thin polymer film on top. And then we come in with the electrons, and we deflect them and make a pattern, a very tiny pattern. Electrons can write on the order of nanometers. And after that, we put it in solution, and where we wrote with the electron, it will take the polymer away. And then we have a pattern on the surface. It's topography that allows us to either etch the underlying material or build up layers. And if Dan, is it going to come up, the last image?
You want the bow tie image? Would that
the
work?
Bow tie. Yeah, throw out the bow tie.
Let's see if I can do that real quick. Let's see.
So while in semiconductor, you're making chips, electronic structures, wires, and interconnects, we take that technology and we make something as simple. We call this a bow tie antenna. The gap between those two little triangles, those are metal triangles made out.
Uh-oh. Something happened with your audio, Dula, or Dula? Let's see. I guess something happened with Deirdre's connection. I can assume she's going to try to get back on here in a second, but so she obviously won't be able to respond to questions. She could probably finish her thought if she does get back on. Here she is. We'll see. We'll give her a second. If not, we'll move on over to Jim.
I'm back. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
I'm very sorry. We're having connection problems.
No problem.
So that little structure of triangles is very powerful. It's 5 nanometers apart from tip to tip, and it takes light and concentrates it in that gap and allows us to see things we normally couldn't see with light. And the idea is to take something like that and integrate it into a medical device. So if you've ever seen Star Trek, for instance, you've seen the tricorder from Dr. McCoy. And so that's going to be composed of all these different sensors and detectors so that you can do point-of-use medical diagnosis. And that little bow tie will be can be one of the elements in that device. The last thing I want to, two things I want to tell you. One is, if you notice, it's a little yellow in this room. That's because the light is actually has yellow light bulbs, because when we have white light in here, the polymer we use also changes under white light. And we only want to change it by the electrons, not the light. So we use the yellow light to protect our polymer and only let it be modified by the electrons. And the other thing I want to say about this is these wafers are very special. They're made from liquid silicon and then crystallized very slowly, so they're made out of single crystal. And so all your chips in your computer start on single crystal silicon. And it's really cool because, first of all, it helps the electrons conduct better. But the nice thing about it is I can take this. This is a diamond scribe. It has a tiny chip of diamond on the end. And I just make a little scratch. And I hope this works. But now it's going to cleave along the crystal plane.
Oh, nice.
So I just cleaved around the 111 plane of silicon. So it has some cool mechanical properties, but it also has, of course, the electronic properties we need. So that's it for me.
Excellent. Thanks. Well, that's what's happening at the nanoscale here, and I'm sure that might prompt any questions. Do we have any from any of the classrooms?
Yeah, we have a question.
Okay.
Rudy has a question.
Excellent. Here we are.
Hi, my name is Rudy Edmondson from the EPA Academy here at Richmond High. And it's coming for Dr. Dula. I was wondering if the model device works like a 3D printer.
This is back to Dula, and okay. Did you catch that, Dula?
Sorry, could you repeat it one more time?
I was wondering if the model device works like a 3D printer.
So I can try and answer your question. You can tell me if this is right. So what we do is we scan the objects, and we're actually able to then have a 3D model in the computer of the object. And actually, one thing we've done a lot for a lot of people is once we have the 3D model in the computer, we can actually take that to our 3D printer and print it out bigger. So, for example, we've got a spider that's only 1 millimeter big, and the researcher wanted to see it better, so we actually scanned it and then printed it out so it was, like, you know, as big as her head. So I don't know if that answers your question, but we do that.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? Possibly questions for Deirdre at the Foundry? Okay, you still might be kind of absorbing, breaking that thing in half so cleanly, so you might have some questions in a second. So we'll move on over to Jim, who's going to drop scales even to smaller scales at the National Center for Electron Microscopy. And Jim, the screen is now yours.
Okay, thank you, Dan. So I'm sitting here at the National Center for Electron Microscopy, and what you can sort of see in the image behind me is one of our sort of highest resolution electron microscopes. It's actually partially disassembled right now and under repair, but it is one of the highest resolution machines on the planet. And so, as Dula had mentioned, just like at the ALS, people visit NSEM from various places around California, around the U.S., and in fact all around the world to come take advantage of the relatively unique capabilities that we have. And so the key thing that we're trying to do with most material systems here is actually we can use these electron microscopes to zoom all the way in down to the level of atoms and in fact take images of effectively individual atoms. And the whole goal of all of these studies is try to understand what is it that drives the behavior of these materials and why is it that some materials are stronger than others, that some have better reactivity than others, and in many cases this has to do with very small differences in arrangements of the atoms. Deirdre spent a little bit of time talking about single crystal silicon, and in fact, yes, these are single crystal silicon are very important for electronic devices, but the reason that they actually work almost at all for computer chips is that one out of every billion or so atoms is not in fact silicon, is replaced by boron. And so there's a great many cases in the functioning of materials and the properties of materials where you have just a few small little defects, and that completely drives all of the scale of the large ensemble as a whole. And so what we're looking at primarily are things that are not 100 times smaller than a human hair, as Dula had mentioned, but more like a million times smaller than a human hair. And that's the sort of length scale and the size that atoms are. And it's a little bit easy to get carried away and say, okay, well, this is a million times smaller than a human hair, or 1/10 billionth of a meter, this kind of thing. But a nice, really good visual example for just how small of the things we're looking at, just how powerful these microscopes are, is if you take an apple and you compare the size of an apple to the planet Earth, that's the same difference as the size of an apple to one atom. So essentially what we're trying to do is zoom in so far on these and blow this up so that the apple would be essentially as big as the Earth, and we want to count individual atoms from that. And so the first image that I've given from Dan shows a picture of a nice single crystal silicon nitride. And in this particular image, the dots are effectively the atoms of the material. And not only can we see the atoms themselves, we can see that some dots are brighter and some dots are dimmer. So the brighter dots are silicon atoms, and the dimmer dots are nitrogen atoms. And so we can not only see where they are, but we can actually tell which atom is what. And this becomes very powerful in trying to understand what's going on, because we can then zoom all the way in, not just on the micron scale, but go much, much deeper into the material, into the length of the material, and try to make connections between the arrangements of these atoms and the large-scale properties. So one of the particular examples of a project that I'm working on has to do with a aluminum material. And so like Dula's first example, this we're interested in aluminums that are lighter but also very much stronger. And what we're especially after is materials that can absorb enormous amounts of energy. So for example, if you were to use this in automobiles during a crash, it's an aluminum that can absorb a huge amount of energy, much more so than a typical aluminum alloy. And so what we've learned from looking at this, if Dan were to put up the second image, is we can now see a very different arrangement of the atoms. And the key aspect of this is you'll see that there's actually sort of hexagon-type features, hopefully, and there's three different hexagons and three different orientations. So when this material deforms, you have these whole giant groups of atoms that can sort of change orientation in a collective way. So you have not just single atoms that are moving, but very large numbers of atoms that are moving and rotating. And as you might imagine, they kind of have to shove a lot of other atoms out of the way as this happens during this rotation. But what that enables the material to do is, because it has to shove so many other atoms out of the way, it absorbs a huge amount of energy when you try to deform the material. And so by zooming all the way in and being able to see these structures at that length scale, we can understand that, okay, so even though we're only looking at a few atoms compared to the giant, huge, you know, say, bumper of a car, we're able to make these relations between what these defects essentially are doing and how that's driving the behavior. So the study of a lot of materials that we look at, we do a little bit more material science, a little bit less biology at the National Center for Electron Microscopy, although we have some users in both fields, is material science. And the whole point behind material science is usually it's the defects that drive the behavior of material. So in some cases, in some very special cases, like the big silicon wafer that Deirdre showed, you can grow an absolutely perfect crystal. But most materials don't behave that way. And so what we're looking for is, what are the small atomic scale defects that drive the large scale behavior? One other brief project that we're working on as well, I think Dan at some point mentioned artificial photosynthesis. And so the idea behind this is, again, mimicking what biology does and trying in some ways to understand how plants can basically take sunlight and turn that into energy. And so we look at some materials that are very good at that. So there's some materials which are powders, that are very, very good at basically sunlight plus water, and you throw some of this powder in there and you get hydrogen that bubbles out. And it happens very, very effectively. And again, this is a case where there's just one single layer of atoms in this material which is completely responsible for the fact that it works. And so even though you have a handful of powder, each little particle of powder has one single layer of atoms that enables it to work. And this is something we're able to discover by zooming in all the way this far. And if we understand what is it about these little tiny defects in the material that make them work, the hope is that we can then learn how to make other things work even better. If we can engineer the right kind of defects or the right kind of atomic arrangements in materials, then we can hopefully make things that are better and stronger and more conductive and more reactive and all sorts of great things.
Excellent. So that I guess sums it up for Jim. And there may be some questions after that. He's talking a lot about what's happening and how to image stuff at the near atomic scale. So are there any questions from either the classrooms, participating classrooms in Petaluma or Richmond?
Yeah, I've got one from our second period biology class again.
Okay, we have you on the screen now.
Okay, so this one is directed for National Center Electron Microscopy. And mm-hmm. This student had a question about whether research is being done on eco-friendly materials and the possible effects of some of the materials on how they might affect animals in the environment.
So did you, so that could be for NSTEM or possibly some other scientists could field that. Did you catch the gist of that question, Jim?
So I heard something about eco-friendly materials and the effect on animals.
Right, yeah. So the question was, is she's wondering if you could use the technology that you have to examine some of the materials bioavailable, something along those lines?
Ah, yes. So, there's a couple of projects that we're working on related to that. Several of the projects, especially in terms of catalytic materials that are good at making reactions faster and more efficient, a lot of these having to do with generation of fuels, is both to decrease the use of materials that are harmful, so things like cadmium or things that are toxic, and also things that are very expensive, like gold and platinum, and trying to develop other catalytic materials that use things more like iron and nickel and copper that are much less both expensive and harmful to the environment. So it is concerned to decrease the sort of heavy metals from a lot of different things, batteries and catalysts. Another project that I'm also involved in has to do with bioavailability of uranium in spent fuels. And so depending on exactly the atomic structure and the chemical environment of uranium and uranium oxide after the fuel is spent, it either dissolves in water or it doesn't dissolve in water. And of course, we would much prefer the kind that does not dissolve in water. And so I'm involved in a project that is trying to understand the surface behavior of these materials and how this chemical change happens that makes it soluble, and ways that we can sort of use different structures that would make it less dissolvable. And if it doesn't dissolve in water, then that means that you can't drink it, which is always a good thing.
Excellent. I think we had just a question just came in via email, and this is directed towards Deirdre. The question was, and this is about nanoscale fabrication, you mentioned some of the technologies that stand to benefit, like computer chips, but what are some of the other technologies that people could be using in their everyday lives 10, 20 years from now that stand to benefit from nanoscale fabrication? What kind of products could we see down the road?
Right. So, of course, right now the biggest driver for what we do, which we call lithography, is shrinking things to make smaller devices, smaller phones, smaller computers. And then the more power you have in your computer, that enables amazing amounts of data computation. So you can do amazing amount of modeling, or you can imagine building artificial intelligence, because if you can shrink the data and put it into a portable system, then you can make a robot that is quite powerful. The other thing I already mentioned that's quite important is the use in medical devices. So we build little labs on chips. So we basically shrink what you might do in an experiment that you might do in the back of your classroom to the size of your thumb and smaller, so that we could, you know, test blood, for instance, and know immediately. For instance, if you're in India, this is a very good example. In India, there's a shortage of doctors, per capita shortage of doctors. So what they're trying to develop is point-of-use diagnostics, which we can build with nanofabrication, that will allow the doctor to be remote and serve many more patients than he would if people had to come to his office. Mm-hmm. So that's one example.
Excellent. Are there any other questions for any of the scientists now?
We have a general question for any of the scientists.
Excellent.
Microscopes are used in a lot of medical field, in the medical field. How will 3D technology change the medical diagnosis?
Interesting. Who wants to take on that question? How 3D imaging will change medical diagnostics?
I guess I can take that. Right now, the same technique that I use at my beamline, which is 3D imaging, is also very commonly used in hospitals. It's the same as a CAT scan or a CT scan. So some of you might have had one. I actually had a CT scan a few months ago. And they're actually able to look inside of a whole person and see a 3D, you know, thing. So that's extremely useful for a lot of reasons. The big difference between a medical 3D and also MRIs and other things are done in 3D. So I'd say 3D imaging is huge in the medical field. The difference between the x-rays that I use at my beamline at the ALS and medical x-rays is that we have a very, very intense beam of x-rays, and it would be lethal. So I think the lethal dose at my beamline is about 1 nanosecond. And so you would not want to put a person in my beamline. And the difference is we're able to look at things at much higher resolution, and that's why we need the intense x-ray beam.
And that's,
go ahead.
We just had a question that came in from Google+, and that kind of gets, I think this answers it. They asked, could you scan something living without it dying? And I think you just answered that question. You did not want to.
Well, so we have scanned living plants. So, we can do things that will decrease the intensity of the X-ray beam and make the lethal dose not so much. So we have scanned living plants, and they have not died. There have been we've scanned living insects before, mm-hmm. but in general we stick with not dead things.
Got it.
Or things that were never alive.
Any other questions from the two participating classrooms?
I've got one in Petaluma.
Okay. You're on the screen.
This is more guided towards the advanced light source. For the visibility of the 3D images of really small things, you see a lot of vesicle structures at the stage of an embryo in something. I know that you said you don't really test living things, but could you see anything about that size in an embryo?
Did you catch that, Dula?
So you're asking about being able to scan an embryo, is that right?
Yeah.
I have never done anything like that, so I'm not totally sure exactly what we could achieve. One challenge is that we use what we refer to here as hard X-rays. So at the advanced light source, we produce all these different wavelengths of X-rays, and as you get shorter wavelength X-rays, we call those hard X-rays. They're higher energy, and then there's also lower energy X-rays, which are called soft X-rays. Hard X-rays are very penetrating, and so it's actually really hard to see contrast between things like within an embryo. So I would say it would be challenging for us to do a good job of imaging an embryo, but there are other beamlines at the advanced light source who use other wavelengths of X-rays and have done things like scanning embryos and actually scanning single cells.
Excellent. Any other any questions from the class?
Yeah, we have another question.
Got it.
My name is Brian. What does the new 3D technology allow us to see that we couldn't before?
I'm not sure. Could you repeat that possibly?
What does a new 3D technology allow us to see that we couldn't before?
So that could be to do it, but possibly others. What can 3D technology allow us to see now that we could not before?
See before, yeah.
I can. Oh, go ahead.
It's wide open. Deirdre?
Well, so some of the things we're working on is actually taking nanoparticles that you can actually put into the body, and this goes back to, can we see things without killing things for treatment. For instance, we're looking at putting nanoparticles of gold, and if you then send in, I know this is, I'll get to the 3D in a minute, and then send in some radiation, you can make them hot very locally, and it can be used for instance, cancer treatment. But we can also use them as reporters for imaging. So if you stick them in a cell and it's targeted to a certain cell in your body, we can use a technique to look inside the body and find that nanoparticle and see where it went in three dimensions within the body. So that's one example.
I could add a little bit to that. I mean, one of the things that Berkeley Lab is all about is developing new technologies that can be applied to a lot of different problems. So, you know, the special thing about my beamline is that we're able to look at very high resolution and do very fast scans. So most of the interesting problems that we're looking at, we're not just looking at one static thing. We're looking at something that's evolving over time. So I gave the example of the composite material and watching cracks develop. We're pulling on that, and we're watching that crack actually develop. Or we're watching water flow through plants. And so I think that, you know, the sky's the limit. There's all kinds of new things that scientists are constantly bringing us new problems that we never thought of, but our technology that we're developing allows them to do new science.
Excellent. Any other follow-up questions from any of the classrooms that are participating?
Yeah, I've got one from Petaluma.
Uh-huh.
This one is, again, from our second period class. So one of the students was reading about a Cas9 protein that was produced. This is from the Molecular Foundry, and her question was, how does this work inside of a cell?
Yes, so we recently, I guess, came out with a news release on some imaging work associated with the Cas9 protein, so that might be a little bit far afield with what some of you are working on, but if that's familiar with you, you can take a stab at it. If not,
I'll just say, this is not my area, but I do work with the scientist who does that imaging, and he does that downstairs. And you asked about, again, 3D. The reason it's so important that what he learned about this protein is, well, that he was able to image it in an electron microscope and figure out its 3D structure, which is, from that, they're learning how it works. But I have yet to learn how it works myself, so.
Excellent.
that will be next.
Got it. I have a quick question for any of us who might kind of sort of illuminate what it takes or what you kind of went through to become a scientist. What were some of these sort of moments in your, you know, as a student that prompted you to go down this field, and how did you get to where you are now? If you want to provide one or two little sentences on how you got to where you are now, that might help the students that are watching.
I guess I can start with that. So I was always fairly into science and just thought it was sort of cool to understand the way the world worked. And I, starting actually with the summer right after I finished high school, I got an internship at Argonne National Laboratory, which is one of the other 17 national labs, actually working at a synchrotron like where Dula works. And so I spent the first summer between high school and college actually working at a synchrotron beamline and sort of understanding, you know, it was the first introduction into like how science actually happens at, you know, the very large scale and the sort of day-to-day life of regular scientists, and sort of went back every summer through college and decided, you know, eventually that maybe I should pursue my PhD and try to be a scientist myself someday. So it was really just about, you know, kind of getting my hands in there and you know, trying it out a little bit and finding kind of a passion for that discovery and that process and wanting to continue to keep doing it.
And then sort of a follow-up to this that somebody else could possibly answer, and this has come through, I think, via email. What is it about your job that you love doing? Why do you love showing up to work?
I can answer that first. Probably the thing that I love most about my job is that I get to interact with so many scientists from so many places around the world who are doing so many interesting things. I mean, it's really amazing to just walk around the ALS, the Advanced Light Source where I work, and just interact with people from so many different countries, and it just sort of blows my mind all the time, all the cool things that they're doing that I had never even thought of. So that's one thing that's really fun for me.
Got it. Okay. We probably have time for, if there are any questions left from the classrooms, we have time for possibly one more. Are there any final questions from the classrooms? Now is your chance. You have three scientists. Go ahead.
One more coming from Helen.
Okay.
So based on the kind of an answer from before, how many people do you really get to work with, or how many scientists do you get to work with in a day? And how many separate projects that are kind of dealing with completely separate topics do you work on in like a workday?
Go
ahead, Deirdre.
So I also work at a user facility like these guys were at the Foundry, and I probably have about 10 to 12 projects at a time. I'm working with, I have students that work here. I have.
Uh-oh. And that might have, looks like her connection might have done something. So Dula.
I can follow up with that. So NSIM is also a user facility like the Foundry and ALS. And yeah, our group is about 10 people, but we have visitors coming in very often. And I'd say there's 20 or 30 projects I'm working on somewhat simultaneously in collaboration with all these people who come through. And that is, again, as Dula mentioned, one of the very exciting things about this particular job is that, you know, every couple of days someone new kind of flies in from a different part of the country or the world, and you get exposed to all these different sorts of projects. For example, this aluminum project I mentioned is in collaboration with someone in Slovenia who has come a couple of times to do some work. And so it's 20 or 30 different things at a time, and it's sometimes hard to keep straight, I have to admit.
That's right. Good. So that's essentially all we have time for today. That about does it. Thanks everybody for joining in. Thanks to the two classrooms. You guys really participated well and some awesome questions. Thanks a lot to Google, who helped us set this up, gave us the idea, and provided a lot of guides on how to do this, and I think is watching right now. So thanks a lot to Google Connected Classrooms for pulling this off. Hopefully this isn't our first field trip. Thanks to our online viewers. We know that we have some questions that came in that we have not answered yet. We don't have time to, but I'll take it on myself to try to track down the questions and the individual scientists, and we'll try to ping back to you hopefully within the next couple days. So look forward to that. And finally, thanks again to our three scientists for taking time out of their day to tell us a little bit about what they do on a daily basis here at Berkeley Lab. If you have any ideas, anybody watching this, about future Hangouts on Airs that we could pull off or try to do on any topics that we typically do, I should have been highlighted that entire time, so this is my first time doing a Hangout, and that's my bad. But if you have any suggestions on future Hangouts on Airs that we can do, feel free to catch us any different ways. That's on Twitter. You can hit us on our Google Plus page or catch us on email. All that information is on our Hangout page. And we look forward to doing these again in the future. So with that, we'll say goodbye, and we'll see you next time at our next Hangout. Thank you very much. Bye, everyone.
Bye. Bye, everybody.